Hi guys, my name's Raven Navera. I run a fashion and lifestyle channel. My content serves to put luxury items with everyday items and just make them look quite chic. I also do a lot of lifestyle stuff with my boyfriend and traveling around the world and that sort of thing. So, yeah.
Do you think Summer in the City has enough intersectional representation?
In the sense of the guests or the panels?
All of it.
If I look around the room right now, I don't see many faces that look like mine around. So I do feel like they can be a bit more diverse in the fact that they could reach out to and let people know, because I'm sure like a lot of people from my background, from the black community, actually don't know that Summer in the City is taking place. Yeah. And a lot of their creators and people who they watch haven't been invited or don't know about it enough to be invited or to want to consider themselves to be there. So I do feel like they could do a little bit more in terms of really reaching out and letting people know that it's actually happening.
Why do you think this particular panel is important?
And I feel like there needs to be a lot of representation for women, not just women of color, not just white women, every single woman. I mean, you've got bloody rainbow hair. That's amazing. It's sparkly. And there's so much representation on the stage right now in terms of body confidence, in terms of what you do as a creator, that I feel like a lot of women, a lot of young girls want to be inspired and look up to this panel and are looking for inspiration for their own channels or their own dreams. I think gaming and tech is something that women are, it's just beginning to become popular, and it hasn't been popular for a long time, and a lot of people still feel like women don't know what they're talking about when it comes to technology. And I'm really embracing and liking the fact that a lot more women are now reviewing technology and getting into gaming and showing that you don't have to be super sexy. And, you know, I've seen lots of singers who would wear really tight tops to promote their singing because it helps them with their channel. But I feel like there are a lot of people who are breaking that mold, a lot of women who are breaking that mold and being like, well, hey, you don't have to do any of this if you don't want to. It's your prerogative and it's your choice. And I think that's a really positive thing that this panel should be about.
I was wondering whether you ever feel pressure to have being a woman be a defining characteristic, like when you're making content and when you're in public and things like that.
Being a woman isn't something that I'm trying to be, it's what I am. So there's no definition of what is a woman and what should a perfect woman be and how, you know, you need to be sort of like this and sort of like the perfect woman. We're all perfect in our own way, so I don't feel like there's pressure on me to be a specific type of woman, but more that from my own audience, there's pressure on me to meet certain expectations that they have become accustomed to. And whether or not that relates to the fact that I am a woman and making that sort of content, then great. Because I am a fashion channel, they will expect me to be fashionable. If I decide one day that I'm going to wear a t-shirt and jeans and just rock up in my house, hey.
But you look great.
Careful here.
That's fine as well. But although sometimes I will get comments like, you didn't make an effort today. That sort of thing. But why does that have to define me? I don't have to be that every day. I feel like if you're a woman who's really into fashion and beauty, you get treated as though you're a little bit ditzy, like you don't really know what you're talking about. And I often have to remind myself, like, okay, wait, I am actually a lawyer. I do have a career. Like, this is what I do. But I do make beauty videos and I do make fashion videos and I'm a little bit crazy online, but that's just me expressing myself. And there are a lot of women who I'm sure here have professions that they've gone into and are very intelligent, and they need to show that as well onto their channels, onto their platforms. That's what you have your platform for. And I think that YouTube and other social media has given women that platform to say, okay, yes, I am into beauty, but I'm also into politics, and I'm also into astronomy or astrology, and, you know, I'm a scientist. You can be more than one thing. You don't have to fit into a mold.
Multifaceted. Yeah.
I'm going to be really honest. I don't have a favorite small YouTuber. I watch a lot of people on YouTube. I'm inspired by a lot of people. I try, if I'm going to be very honest, I try not to watch a lot of YouTube content, especially if it's related to what I do, because I don't want to be influenced by anybody else. no idea is original, no idea is your own. So when I do come up with an idea and I'm like, oh, this is great, and then I go onto YouTube and I see like somebody just did it like yesterday, I'm like, oh. But if I watch it, I don't want to subliminally think of that person's content and then recreate that same content. So I do watch a lot of people, but I can't pick and choose right now who it is that's my favorite. I'm going to be very honest with you guys. I haven't spoken about this on my channel. In fact, I haven't spoken about it publicly, but I had such an experience. I was molested when I was young, when I was a little girl. And I remember telling family members what had happened. And instead of putting the onus on the person who had done it, it was for me to protect myself. Or, you know, I was told that I couldn't go outside and play, or I was told that I couldn't do certain things anymore to stop that person from being tempted to do anything to me. And I feel like, going back to what you said, the onus is on the person who's done what they've done. And also, if a victim, I don't consider myself a victim, you know, I feel like I've sort of dealt with it and moved past it, but there are a lot of people who haven't dealt with it, who don't know how to approach it and don't know who to talk to, and they feel like they will be victimized and blamed if they do come up to someone and say something. And I feel like the people, if you go to someone and say that you've had this experience, it's for that person to help you and to put the accountability on the person who did the crime in the first place. So I don't think what can the victims do except speak up and say what they've been through and try to find some sort of accountability in the person who did them wrong?
Can I just say that was very courageous? Yeah. I think you deserve more than applause, but thank you.